new faces and some familiar faces. Welcome to Tomo Lab at Blue Hall. This is one of our three locations for startups at the University of Washington. The other two are our Startup Hall, which opened about 2 years after this one. You'll see me there, or I'm kind of responsible for things in that community. And then H2 opened 2 years later, in just August of this past year. And H2 is dedicated to VR and AR startups. And it's a very exciting part of our three community system here. Startup Hall, real quickly, is IT, SaaS, apps, software. And I'm particularly honored to introduce our speaker today, as he, I call him kind of a Hall father. He was instrumental in the launch of Startup Hall, deeply involved as our representative of our partner, Up Global, in the launch of Startup Hall. Dave is a pillar of the startup community in Seattle. He sort of makes Startup Week amazing in Seattle every year. He has helped countless entrepreneurs in their journey in this community and across the West Coast. He's on the board of 12 advisory boards.
More than 12 advisory boards.
Our data is a little out of date. A veteran of 5 startups that you started your
startup.
10 transactions. Outstanding. He's currently CEO of GoPro. So without further ado, let's give a really warm welcome to Dave Parker, and let's learn all about leveraging Seattle tech and entrepreneurship.
Well, hey, welcome. I'm going to walk over a little bit of the agenda we're going to cover with you today. Some old faces, some old friends, which is really cool. This is designed to be interesting content and overview from a kind of big picture to what you can go do like this week to go help get yourself grounded in the startup community to be able to leverage forward. But it's also, if you have questions as we go, feel free. This presentation is on my blog, also on LinkedIn, it's on Twitter. So I will try to make sure I get questions before the event, which is sometimes problematic because I don't want to push myself around the slide deck like not to you just before we do it. So Mercedes was very excited on tour last night, sent it to her this morning, and I actually retooled it. So you can find all of them there. So if you have questions about all the links that I included in it from a resource perspective, they'll be here at 4 p.m. From agenda, can you talk a little about job, I'll give you a little more background. I'm going to talk about kind of ecosystems from an overview perspective, what makes a great startup ecosystem and why Seattle is pretty unique. We're going to talk specifically about Seattle, and then ultimately I have to give you some tools that can be useful for you to figure out how to get plugged into the startup ecosystem. From that perspective. I'm also going to give you what to avoid. Second, there's some niches in the startup ecosystem, you need to know about them, and just avoid them, a couple of them you just run over. So, and then open it up for some of your questions. So first off, the welcome to everyone is a very deliberate effort to say, a startup ecosystem is a community, nobody owns a community, and everybody's invited to the community. One of the things that I've done from working with Up Global is when you're around other ecosystems, it's like, well, this is our community. And other people aren't welcoming our community. And I own the community. I'm the patriarch of the community, right? So when somebody says you're Nate's comment about being a pillar, just means I'm old. So in 1998, when I started my first startup, none of the startup ecosystem that we have today in Seattle existed at all. It was a bit of a rough time. Terry actually and I worked together in my last job that I had before I started my first startup. So that was a unique time because there was a bunch of folks who were like, hey, we need to go. And there's like, there's nothing. So I remember having a group of CEOs that there were 8 of us CEOs sitting around the table with each other going, I don't know, what would you do? Right? There was nobody who'd gone, kind of, a lot of folks before us, right? Bill Gates wasn't available to enter that one. So everyone's welcome to the starting meeting. Some resources for you. We did a white paper when I was in Up Global. And you know, if you're going to start weekend, anybody going to do a start weekend? So Up Global was a parent company to start weekend at Start America. So in 2014, we did 1,265 events worldwide in 120 countries with 74,000 attendees. So one of the things we learned through that was what makes a good startup ecosystem. And that resource is there, paper on a meta level of the topic, what makes great startup community. So there's chairs up here in front too if you want to have a table. Still, I showed up late to church. So five ingredients are talent, which is no surprise. So if you have a community that has solid talent, both on the, what we would always call the hacker, hustler, designer side, it's kind of the three basic functions of the startup. Sometimes you're weighted more and less on the skill set. But from a hacker, hustler, designer perspective, that's really the talent, obviously, he does a great part of that talent. But to give you a sense of the scope, if you're doing it, how many of you are thinking about being a startup? Being a founder? Okay. How many of you are interested in joining a startup? How many of you are registered for free food? Right. So from a talent perspective, the challenge in Seattle and Washington State right now is 24,000 open IT jobs. All of the universities across, including UW, Campus, Fossil, Tacoma, PLU, every other college will generate about 2,200 students this year to graduate. So the talent gap for us, what's happening now in Seattle, is that there are more jobs posted than there is talent available. So finding talent to help you launch your product, if you're thinking about software in particular, which by the way, most of my bias is towards software, I mean some other things as well. I come on the board of any ULC company, it is as non-tech as I've ever experienced. But it's my one and only non-tech. So most of my stuff would be focused towards tech. I've got a question like, why are there companies here in Seattle, but why are there not many companies in Belgium? And then number one answer to that is density. There's not very much class B office space that's walking distance to restaurants in Belgium. There are like two class B Belgium buildings, maybe in California Kitchen. There's a hundred buildings that are surrounded by now high rises. That building, the one across the street from Poland, is the only class B space downtown Belgium that's close enough to actually walk the food. And it was like, how come Belgium doesn't have more startups? It's really simple. There's not enough flexible class B space to matter. And what I mean by that is flexibility has to do with, can I get a short amount of term lease? Because if my first startup that I grew went from 0 to 150 employees and earned $2 million in sales in 4 years. When we signed our first lease, they're like, well, you know, it's kind of 5-year lease. We're like, 5 years? We don't know what we're gonna be in 5 months, right? So that flexibility, not just price, but flexibility is important. Culture. Do you have a culture that accepts failure or not? Do you have a culture of the startup and taking risks? The further east you go, to New York, to Japan, et cetera, the more risk-averse cultures become. So in Japan, I've been in business there for about 15 years, people actually taking risks is very weird, right? So the cultural risk of having a safe base makes it very risk-averse culture. So you don't see many entrepreneurs anymore. On the East Coast, if you fail, you have a big scarlet letter F on your chest. If you fail multiple times in South Silicon Valley, it's a big deal, right? Seattle's a little bit of a hybrid, though. So you can still fail, you can't do it twice. So capital, obviously, always a challenge. There's never enough capital in any market. And last but not least, regulatory environment. I'll tell you, I spent 3 days this week in Washington, D.C., walking around the Hill on Wednesday and meeting with 5 senators and congressmen about issues around tech as part of the NTA. It was actually way more interesting and useful than I expected to be. Which is a different story I'll talk about later, but it was surprising me how people were willing to listen about areas that they didn't know much about. Which I thought was very interesting. Other resources are the Startup Champions Network. If you want to become a part of the Startup Champions Network, I can share more about it. But there's about 35 cities that get together twice a year, a group of people who are community builders to figure out how it would be in your city. What do you do that in Tampa? You should do that in Seattle. Oh, what do you guys do in Baltimore? Oh, Baltimore, that's a really cool thing about it. Because there's a whole like not invented here mentality that all of us kind of bring in our own view of the world, right? We're like, oh, well, Seattle invented it. Startup Communities is another resource for you if you're interested in communities. Brad Feller's written a book called Startup Communities. It's a great resource. Great book. He talks about the Boulder thesis. And Boulder is a really unique city. So at our Startup Week here, we have 4,200 people who show up for Startup Week. Boulder has 12% of the city that shows up for Startup Week. right? And it's a really interesting culture. So Brad basically wrote part of the book around both of this idea, what makes a good startup community. And it starts with the fact that entrepreneurs lead. Tom and I were talking a little bit ago about the fact that MIT Forum used to be, I don't know if you're still around, but when I first went to the MIT Forum, there were probably 50-60% entrepreneurs and 40-50% service providers. And then the last time I was there, it was 80% service providers and 20% entrepreneurs. So the challenge in both of these is the entrepreneurs have to lead because service providers can't. And when you get disproportionate service providers, that event will die. And over the next 10 years, you will see it happen. There will be like this amazing event. There will be a disproportionate amount of startup-related jobs. And then over time, more service providers will come in and take a leadership role as volunteers. And then pretty soon, it will be just service providers talking to you. And I can name a bunch of organizations who've got to do that. Yeah, no, long-term view of the city, right? There's no fast track to the startup. If you don't know that, the average startup gets successfully exited at the 8-year mark. So the classic kind of 8-year overnight success story is what startups have. The 2-year flip view, pretty unusual. And typically a company's been growing for 5 or 6 years before they even burn. So anybody know Limeade or Novi? So amazing company, Henry's an amazing guy. They are an 8-year overnight success story. When you raise $40 million, you're like, Limeade, crazy! Well, they've been amazing for 8 years, actually. So, inclusive of all long participants, big deal, and continual activities and events. So then what we saw when I was with UP was that I can build all these other communities. So I had a chance to go to Budapest, a whole bunch of international places. So tell us what to do to grow our startup community. I'm like, great. They're like, give us an example. San Francisco. I'm like, San Francisco is not a good example. You didn't start in 1971. You didn't have Northrop Grumman. You didn't have federal dollars. By the way, if you want a history, there's a great history of Silicon Valley that Steve Blank does at Stanford. It's just an awesome video on the history of Silicon Valley. But one of the challenges for Seattle is we have a chip on our shoulder because we're not the Valley. We're never going to be the Valley. We get a chance to be in an awesome Seattle. Now, having grown up in Portland, I don't think we have a chip on our shoulder that it's not Seattle. Right? And Vancouver has a chip on our shoulder, it's not something else. So as a community, we never look back and compare ourselves to people who aren't as good as we are. We only compare ourselves to the bad ones. Right? It's kind of goofy in a way, but really good. So continual activities and events. Well, I was city of Iowa. Went through a flood about 8 years ago. That flooded downtown. Now, I flooded downtown Iowa City, not that unusual. But a year ago, it was massive. And two people got together and formed a small group of people who said, listen, we need this to be a startup community. How are we going to do that? And they started doing that. And they did 1,000 copies, 1 million copies, and they did startup weekends. They did this, they did that, they tried a bunch of other things, they did copies, they did meetups. And 5 years later, they did this amazing demo day with an amazing accelerator with 650 people over, and everybody's like, Iowa City. I didn't know it was in Seattle or San Francisco or Paris. And the answer is, no, actually, if you do the stuff Iowa City did, you will grow. So today, you're the benefactors of the fact that we started doing those things a long time ago. And I say we because no one gets to take credit for it, but it wasn't me who did it. If you decide to be an executive or leader in any organization, anytime a team does something good, they get credit. Anytime failure happens, it's you. So the great quote says, success has many fathers, but failure's an orphan. So in the case of the Seattle startup community, there's a lot of folks in the Seattle startup community and a lot of people who paved the way. And a lot of you will go continue to pave the way after I'm long out of it, which is great. So talk about leaders and leaders, is one thing that Brad talked about in the book. And I'll go through the detail in context of Seattle. So Peters, who are Peters? Government is a Peter. Having been there this last week, a unique opportunity to understand that they're following and looking for us to set an example as leaders to say, here's what we need. Here's how you can help. Politicians, if you don't know, and this is from going to visiting the Hill perspective, as much as I was cynical as some of you are sitting here right now, that's not true. So what I found was there are a mile deep, and this deep and a mile wide on every topic. So when we came and talked about specific topics about funding education for apprenticeship programs, they were like, really?
You guys had those sort of numbers in that first day?
Super interesting and aware and wanted to listen. So government follows leaders, but they don't set a pace for leaders. Government doesn't create jobs, right? Small, fast growth companies and new growth companies create jobs. The Fortune 500 and has now gone from an average lifespan of 50 years to less than 20 years. So brands that you know today in 15 years aren't going to exist. And brands that are emerging today are going to create all of the jobs. So that's the Kauffman Study Foundation. And so the government will follow, but they won't lead. Universities create an amazing, great group of smart young people, which is why I'm working at the BYOB program, which is build your own business with an undergrad program for entrepreneurship. Now, the challenge for most of the young people, though, at the university level, is us as entrepreneurs to say, go fix a problem that you know about. And when you do the top three problems, leave a resonance. Cheap food delivery, textbooks, and dating. Now, when Snap goes public next week, dating is a hell of a startup, right? And there's always more things coming in the dating problem. But they didn't necessarily fix or address large enterprise problems. Right? So some of you have come from a background where you have a depth of knowledge in enterprise as well. Right? So investors, in case you don't know, they actually follow talent. Talent doesn't necessarily come to them, with the exception of San Francisco, obviously, is a big pull for talent. Because if you live in Kansas City, it's really hard to get funded, where sometimes people are like, you just need to move to Seattle, or move to Kansas City. And I've been asked to move to San Francisco for one of the other priorities. So the angels and VCs both, the talent comes here as a company talent. So if you as a founder of a startup company, you have to get more talent or more venture capital come back to Seattle. And get more of your investors out there. Measures. Oh, for net economics or a little economics. And what I mean by that, and I'll get to the leases here in a little bit, is I mentor and give back because it's the right thing to do for the community, not because I'm taking 1, 2, or 10% of the company. It's just the right thing to do. And if somebody tries to do something other than that, we'll get to those in a bit. Professional services, legal and accounting, and what I say by real professionals, is not the people who hang out at events, but actually the attorneys who help you incorporate the right way. The accountants to make sure you file the right thing at the right time. So having professionals in the community help you do that is a big part of the supporting organization. And last but not least, large companies are a big part, both on the acquisition side. So if you have a company that is going to grow and be acquired, there's this philosophy called the Big Five. So Amazon, Microsoft, Apple, Google, Facebook. All of them are downtown now. Apple just took 5 floors of a building downtown. So the only one who wasn't here in any presence is now here. So from an acquisition standpoint, they're there. How do big companies help spin out resources of folks who are looking for jobs in the entrepreneurship market? So depending on the culture of the business. Some of those cultures are better than others as far as being entrepreneurial. Well, those are the feeders. So let's talk about events. So from an event perspective, today there are literally dozens of events every month that you can go to. When we started Startup Week 3 years ago here in Seattle, okay, somebody will let us go. I'm thinking about moving to the Valley because there's no resources here, or at least there's nothing. And I'm like, what the hell? What are we working on? I'm just not paying attention. Right, there are literally dozens of meetups every month from topics around, you know, completely geeky and tech to completely business-oriented and marketing. And you can go to meetup.com, search for your location, and put in any keywords that are interesting to you and find people who think like you or want to think like you about particular things. Hopefully you can contribute and add value, so I'm going to change it for everyone. So Startup Week this year, we did 4,200 unique individuals. It'll be, by the way, the first week of October next year, or sorry, this year. It's grown from 1,500 uniques to 4,200 uniques over the last 2 years. So we had 150-ish events, 154, over 5 days and 65 venues. So east side, west side, so a couple of folks back with dollars in the whole house. Startup Weekend, Hackathon. We were just talking about, there was a Startup Weekend last weekend. If you've never been to a Startup Weekend, and you're thinking about you're building a team, So start thinking sort of again as a pickup basketball game for people who want to do sort of.
Am I going to give another woman an idea after we get?
You're right. It's okay. But you're going to network with a group of people who you've never met before and find out you connected with somebody who's actually had resources that you need. Like I found an awesome designer. Well, it's a person on the business side was great. I saw this person go and do a lot of customer research. That person was a developer. So the question of, Dave, can you introduce me to a CTF? The answer is no. But you can go to events like that before you meet your interesting guy. So it's all about your own investment. Ignite's a great event. It's inspirational. It only happens 6 times a year. There's another great example of an event where you get plugged into a And these are just some examples of events that are going on currently. And by the way, down here, anybody recognize LMG, TLI? Let me Google that for you. It's actually a website. It'll give you all the search engine results. Because everyone's Google. Do you know about? No, but let me Google it for you. Hey, have you thought about it? No, let me Google it for you. But you guys can Google it for yourself too, which is awesome. So there's a whole bunch of events you can go be a participant in today. So go look for those events. And if there's not an event that you think is interesting and you want to go start one, Meetup is really a great way to mechanically do that. So I would encourage you to think about doing that as well. Resources. Community calendars. So Startup Seattle was started by Red Rusek and it was bought by the City of Seattle. It's a list of events that are going on in the City of Seattle. Each wire's weekly calendar, great resource. Nothing's going on in the community. Does it have everything? No, but it's a great place to start. Newsletters. Startup Digest is a newsletter that comes out every Monday, curated by Red Rusek. Red basically takes all the events coming around and people submit to him, decide whether they're good events as a curator, and sends those out to you on a weekly basis. So every week there's a curated list of events going on in your community that you may be interested in. Most of them are free. So from a startup community perspective, we try to push on the fact that if you're gonna help startups, you can't charge $400 to go to the event, because startups don't have the money to do that. So startup subscribe to Startup Digest. From a group's perspective, WTIA tends to be established in more later stage companies, but they still do a number of events for the startups as well. And then last, if you look at groups, please check their motives by following the cash. Any group that wants to charge startups a great deal of money to attend an event is not really a startup group. So, by the way, the 155 events we did, 3 of them had a charge. And I think the most expensive one was $15 or $20. So, but we try to do that every year where they're free. And to make it in the list, you have to be free. That, those are some groups and resources. Physical resources, co-working space, you heard from Nate, Startup Hall, you've got a bunch of commercial co-working spaces, you've got major spaces like here, you've got vertical spaces like Henry Rose, just to help. So basically, there's spaces available now that will help you in the categories of finding a location to go hang out with your team or meet like-minded people. And if that's vertically oriented, great. And if that's horizontal or just a space, but look at the DNA of who they attract. So for example, WeWork tends to attract a lot of what I would call solopreneurs, consultants, and small business folks. They're relatively small teams, two or three people, where as you go up the supply chain, galvanized tends to be more teams. So depending on where you are at the stage of your company, depending on who you want to be around, know what kind of the DNA of the organization is like. Because all of them have their own DNA. So Impact Up, for example, their DNA is around social impact. So they're really important. So those are the physical resources that are available. So as we talk about investors, I wanted to set the investor discussion up with this. Your need for capital does not equal your ability to raise capital. Which often founders get confused. They're like, Dave, you don't understand, I need to raise capital. No, I understand, you need to raise capital. But that doesn't mean you can't. So before we talk about investors, I want to give you that context, because I want to help you get ready to do it before you actually go headlong into the investment side and say, we're going to go raise money. No, you're not. So my first startup in 1988, I raised money in the back of the napkin and an idea. Today, you're not going to do that. I know your idea is special. And not shortcut special, but like special. But that doesn't really matter. You still need traction to raise money. Okay? All right. So There are programs, like going to UW Entrepreneurship School or Seattle University or Founders Institute, where you pay to attend that program. And they have varying durations. So UW Entrepreneurship is a one-year MBA program. I encourage you to look at that if you want to learn the things about entrepreneurship on a very broad basis. Seattle is similar. Founders Institute, I think it's 12 weeks or 14 weeks. And it's a paid program. It's really an entrepreneur training program. It's not a launching company program. So if you have a startup and an idea, what's going to happen is you're going to start with the ideation stage, and oftentimes you're going to pivot away from that idea to another idea. But you decide you want to go start a company, paid programs are great for that, but don't look at them to actually help you launch a company. They're going to give you an education that can help you get ready to become a good entrepreneur. And frankly, it's a great investment. Right? If you think you want to be an entrepreneur, a lot of your ideas are going to, you're going to put together a process by which you can help that idea die fast and save money. You can get money back, but you can't get time back. And on the funded side, there's companies like TechStars and Pledge, for an impact investment-oriented startup. You have to actually do a crowdfunding campaign before you get accepted into the program. But then the program is very structured to help you launch the company. I'll tell you from a TechStars perspective, we have 450-plus companies applied to the last cohort, and we took 10. So the time before that, we had 650-plus applying, and we took 10. So I'm both an investor in that fund and a mentor, but I also help on the front end of the sorting process, looking for what are your unique companies. So if you have an idea and you want to go apply to TechStars, the great part is they're a startup call. The challenge is it's crazy competitive. So you're going to need traction and momentum from a customer perspective before you're getting it. 9 Mile has closed as an accelerator. They're just a real estate venture fund now, so if you've heard that name in the past, they're no longer an accelerator, they're just a venture fund, which is good too. From an investor perspective, there's two categories of investors. There's angel investors. So as an individual, I will occasionally write a check, but I'm investing my own money with the approval, of course, of the boss. So, because I have to take your idea home with my wife and tell her why I'm going to invest in this crazy ass idea, right? So there's still people that review my decision, but on the venture side, it's other people. So I have what's called a charter as a venture investor, and I have limited partners, and you all are my limited partners. And I told you I'm going to invest in technology companies in the Northwest, predominantly focused on X and Y. Now, if a biotech company in Silicon Valley comes, can I invest in it? No, because I've told you my charter is to invest in these things. Your expectation is I will invest in the charter of things I told you I would invest in. So if your idea doesn't match with the charter, will they invest in your idea? Nope. But your idea is amazing. Doesn't matter. Because they have a charter that they said they're going to invest in, and they want to invest off charter. Will they take a meeting with you anyway? Maybe. Will you come out of the meeting feeling like, it was an amazing meeting? Probably. Will it be accurate? Probably not. Right? So, because investors, especially sitting in the phrase Seattle Nice. Okay, what Seattle Nice means for those of you who don't know is somebody will come in, you'll come talk to me about, I have this amazing idea, it'll be great, you should do blah, 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 and they'll be like, hey, let me know how it goes. When in their mind, they're thinking, here's the 6 reasons it won't work. But Seattle Nice says, I don't want to like be negative. So rather than giving you valuable feedback, I'll just give you no feedback. I just don't like it. I wish the investor community in general would say, listen, here's the 3 things I'd like to see you go execute on, and if you go execute on, come talk to me. But otherwise, they concern me so much I wouldn't write a check. But no one wants to take that risk that if Terry does a deal that's amazing, I want to come back to me later and let me invest in it at when the risk is less. So anybody know OfferUp with him? Okay, OfferUp raised $140 million on their last round. They were $1 billion, they're the only unicorn valuation company, so $1 billion valuation. All the early stage venture capital folks in Seattle passed on them 6 years ago. So when they raised $40 million and $140 million in their last 2 rounds, did they take any Seattle money? Nope. Because all the Seattle investors passed on them and didn't give them feedback. It was just a great lesson, I love.
Dave, how did they make money?
How do they make money?
Yeah.
So their business, don't get me started on business model. So their business model is based on traffic and the amount of time spent on site and taking a transaction fee. So think of them as the Craigslist, So if you don't have it on your phone yet, get OfferUp. It's a visual version of Craigslist by looking at photos on your phone. The reason I got a valuation cut was their time on app is on average higher than Facebook's time on app. Because then you're like, oh, I understand that key metric now. So they follow closer to what's called the new media marketplace, or the new media business model, which is you can figure out when you get customers that fast and they spend that much time on site, the investors are like, we'll figure it out. Right? And the monetization is you can literally use PayPal, which is credit card, and do a transaction from your phone. And instead of Craigslist, it's showing up as some creepy person. All right, so Alliance of Angels, terrific group. Angel Pitches from here happens about every other month. That's Gary Rubin's event. He's in a venture club, small price to pay to get in. All of you have sometimes a small application fee, maybe $50 or $100. Down here at the bottom is don't pay to present. So there's a group down called the Forensic Forum. Do not pay to present. So here's the deal with angels and angel groups. If you have a lead term sheet on your deal and you're 50% less than a $2 million round, they will help you raise the rest of the money to close the round. But you need what's called a lead investor. Because without a lead investor, nobody else is going to follow and write a check. So in the case of Credit Suisse Forum, you have to pay $1,500 for each event you have to pitch at, and you have to pitch in four cities: Boise, Portland, Seattle, and I don't know what the other city is. Where is it?
Canada.
Oh, Canada. Then you have to pay $6,000 or something silly to go present at all four of those locations. Because their business model is to get you to pay them and present at their events. So just save yourself some time. Don't do it. There's some really nice people there, and they have good intent. But for a startup, if you have $1,500 to spend on that, or $1,500 to test an AdWords campaign, test the AdWords campaign, for God's sakes. Like, get a return on investment.
So, question.
Yeah.
So there is a small fee for like Puget Sound Venture Group.
Yeah.
It's small, so that's okay to pay that because it's small. What about, I'm glad you brought this up, because I remember you talked about this before, and I just was presented at a group of women funders that are hosting an event. It's $4.95 to be exposed to a 2-minute pitch and angel investors. Should I spend that money or not?
No.
Yeah,
okay, I said no. So, I mean, a $50 application fee for Gary and Houston Venture Club is to keep wacky people who have no ideas from showing up randomly and trying to pitch, right? And they're going to feed you lunch. So, for that, $50, you're in. Right? For something close to $500, the answer is spend your money on stuff that gives you return on investment. There is no shortcut to raising capital than going out and meeting with investors. And we'll get to having introductions here in a minute. But there's the investors actually want to meet you, right? But they also want an introduction to meet you, and they want you to be concise about what you're doing. So there's no set of requirements that I've studied before you pitch, you're going to do that, and you can look at requirements and set. You were there, Jan?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Early stage venture capital founders co-op is based over in Startup Hall. 7Peaks is based in Bend, Oregon. They like to invest in deals here. They see it as a very northwest centric view of the world. And Flying Fish is a new fund that's getting ready to announce to kind of see how they're looking. From a venture perspective, Madrona is a big dog. They've been a big dog. They're the key makers in Seattle. You can go present to them early. The odds of them funding you early is really low. Because since they're the biggest game in town, they see all the deals. Sometimes they pass on them, but they do see them all. Voyager Capital has been more active in the Bay Area recently than they are here. They've been partnering here, funding around for quite a while. Initially, tends to be more enterprise software oriented, a bunch of ex-Microsoft folks based in Bellevue. And Maveron is Howard Schultz's family money, plus some limited partners. So they're not focused on geography, they're focused on retail and concepts and things that are very retail oriented. So if you're doing enterprise software, don't bother talking to Maveron. Is the team smart? They're amazing. Only in their category. Right? So you just need to know that that's what they invest in. And again, the list is up there, it's easy to find. So let's talk about introductions and why they matter and how you can get ready for it. So you have to invest in your network to get introductions. So if I don't know you, will I introduce you to anybody in the room? Dave, I introduced you to you. Would you introduce me to Greg? No. Because I get to play that card only so many times. And if I don't know that you're actually doing something interesting or having traction or something, it's really hard for me to introduce you. So you have to work on building your network and investing in your network. Then go accomplish something. Ship a product. Get some traction. Interview 50 potential customers. So even if you're not technical, you could create a PowerPoint that shows what it is you're trying to do, and you could go show 50 potential customers. And if you came back to me and said, I've interviewed 50 people, and 38 of them said they would pay me X amount for the product, I'd be like, that's amazing. But you're like, I interviewed 5 people, 3 of them were family members, and they loved me, and they all loved it. And it's like, no. So even if you're not technical, you can still go test that idea. So you need to be ready to do that. Get a clear ask. What do you want? So I'll get to that in one second. Avoiding leeches. All right. I told you not to go over there where they charge you to apply. But here's a few other things you need to know. You folks in the ecosystem, other than there's the leaders, there's the feeders, and these are the leeches. The leeches in the marketplace are the people who never sponsor. And what they'll do is they'll get up here in the pitch part and say, my company does blah, blah, blah. If you need services of this, let me know. And it's like, why are you pitching? You're like trying to sell your company services in an event you're not a sponsor of. It makes me crazy. I shut them down in the middle of their sentences. It makes me so crazy. Right? I'm like, stop talking. So it happened that it started running at you and tell you about it. And I'm like, leave the button. Stop talking. You did not pay a bitch. There are other people who are sponsors. They're amazing. You want to support them? But me, I can't say anything. There are people who are alarmers. They're always talking about the thing they're going to start, but they never actually started. So, not have to be offensive if you're one of those. I would just encourage you to start them. There's a star of theories. There are most of you. You know who you are. And then there's the fundraisers and introducers, and these are the folks you just need to run the hell away from. They're like, oh, you have a reason to get, I can help you get funded. Now, there's a lot. There requires FINRA regulated broker dealers, if they're going to get a commission, to help you financially. And if somebody said they will kind of help you raise money, and I've got the question, and they come back later and say, oh, if you raise money, it'll cost you 7%. And they're not an authorized broker dealer, run away. The fact is, you have to go do all the work of raising money anyway, and the only people who can raise money for you is an authorized broker dealer. That's it. There are people who can help you sell companies without being an authorized broker dealer, but they can't help you raise money for you. So I have a people working, hey, will you help me? Can you pay me? No, you can't pay me. I'm not a broker dealer. So if you run across those people, run away and move on. We have a group called Help a Seattle Startup, which is an email listserv. It's totally old school. They should do that. And there's a group that goes on, and every once in a while, they're popping up a question. They're like, hey, we're doing our fundraising thing, and somebody asked us to post a great money for a fee, and literally all the CEOs are like, no, don't do it. Right? And I signed up for that the first time, so you know, made that mistake. Ended up paying a fee for somebody raising money. We didn't help you raise money without the people that you're giving a fee, and they were completely useless. And they gave me the introductions that anybody like me would have given me anyway. It's crazy. So, and by the way, investors don't like it when you have that piece of stuff. Regional markets. So a quick note on just kind of where we fit into the general ecosystem of things. The East Side continues to add a lot of class these days. I've talked about that earlier. There's some new co-working space coming out on the East Side, which I'm hopeful will help the East Side pick up from a little bit more startup-oriented perspective. But Impact Hub over there is kind of it's just a horrible building and location, and everybody knows it's going to get torn down and turn into a train station. Okay, so it's just not great space. So they do good work in really crummy space. But if space matters to you, you look at that window. So East Side versus West Side, you have a stack difference. So if you're thinking about launching a technology company and you want to use .NET, go to the East Side. If you want to use MeanStack, if you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry about it, you'll figure it out later. If you want to use open source stack, you're going to go to West Side. Because there's a West Side stack and an East Side stack. It's really quirky by the East Side. Kind of true. So developers experts on the east side tend to have backgrounds in Microsoft and .NET oriented technology. People on the west side tend to have open source oriented stacks from Amazon and others. So if you need to decide on your technology stack, different blog posts will want to do. Rest of Washington, we have some really interesting dilemmas around Spokane and Vancouver and Tacoma and Everett and Bellingham. There's some really tough, there's just a lack of talent, both on the entrepreneur side as well as the technical resource side, to actually be fundable. And because ideas and US founders are mobile, you have to know where the money is for the most part, as long as it's within this interesting writing business and start kind of getting on here. I live on the east side, I've lived on the east side forever. I've only started one of my five companies on the east side. Just because the talent is on the west side for what I need to do. Cascadia, Vancouver, BC, to Portland, and Ben, which Leaf actually knows more about this one because he's been traveling that more than I have. So Leaf will be in the community consulting team for my income. Lots of interesting stuff happening in Vancouver. Vancouver has an interesting dilemma with respect to the meta things we're having about some density. So much money is flowing into Vancouver to buy houses, so there's very little housing available for young tech workers who want to work there. So they're finding different places to go. Now, with the exception of the recent visa issues and H-1B fears, there's a mass in the last few weeks of people looking to start new development centers in Vancouver and take their H-1B talent and move to Canada, because Canada's like, we'll take that, that'd be amazing. Smart on Vancouver's perspective. Portland has the same dilemma that we have here, which is oftentimes a lack of capital. Capital constraint is true in every market. So if you hear people whining about the lack of capital in Seattle, tell them to get the fuck over it. So completely aggravating. Sorry for those of you who are offended. It's one of those that it's like we drag this thing along with us and we're like, oh, Seattle will never be big because we can't. No, that's not true. Every market is cash limited. So have a kick-ass idea, and it will be amazing. If you don't have a kick-ass idea, you won't get funded. So you have to be in that mindset. All right, how to plug in the ecosystem. We'll be super tactical in this last 10 minutes or so. You'll notice over here it says, there are not enough funds in your account to cover your check 1, 2, 3. Some of you are at the start of your relationship with the Seattle ecosystem for the startup community. And the answer is, you do not have enough funds in your account to cover what you're asking. So you need to start investing. And the way you invest in the startup community is to go build relationships. And this is more than networking. This is the, hey, I know we met before, by the way. Yeah, it's good to see you. So how can I help you? What are you looking for? Right? So when you're networking, it's not about, hey, can I tell you about my idea? No. What are you looking for? I'm looking for a developer. Hey, I'm looking for this. I'm looking, what can I help you do? How can I help you? Let me invest first. Right? So what I want to be able to do when I can actually go to networking events, people tease me about it. Like, why do you go to networking? Like, because you're always investing in people. There's always a next generation of people coming up who have killer ideas, who I want to help. It's weird. But if you've been around this ecosystem long enough, you know that the more we invest like that, the better it pays off for everyone. So you build a relationship. Start with people first. Tech stars hashtag is give first. I love that. Right? And the answer is you give with that anticipation of getting anything back. So our startup community is very good that way for the most part. Every once in a while we'll come across some takers. What you find is the takers typically get rooted out fairly fast, and people end up knowing who they are. So figure out how you give first and bring that to the community. From a practical standpoint, volunteer. I can tell you the number of events I could use help with the registration desk, I could use help doing marketing support, I can use help doing social media. Like, go invest in the community and become known. Because right now, you're not known. And you need to get that. And the way you do that is to go volunteer and help. That's it. By the way, in our community, everyone is special, not just you. So Seattle suffers a little bit from being too humble. Right? We don't brag enough. We're not as brash as San Francisco is. People are like, Seattle is very humble. But Seattle generally is a pretty humble town, has a pretty humble community. So, you know, there's a number of exits that have happened for north of $100 million in companies you don't even know. That's crazy, but kind of cool. So you need to figure out what it is you can help get your shoulder leaning into it and go make a difference and get a no. But once you do that, you'll start investing in the community and become known. So invest first. Then once you invest, have an agenda, right? This happens to me a lot. People call me with kind of random requests. And it's like, okay, I know you have an agenda. Just tell me what it is. It'll save us so much time to be figuring it out. Like, am I really the right person to help you with that? Maybe, yeah. So know what your agenda is. Start with it first. You need product feedback, you need connections. Ultimately, when we finish the meeting, my question for you is, did your interaction add value to that person's life? And if it didn't, then you failed, right? You're still on the teeter-totter of things. You move the balance over here where you have no leverage. The more you invest in the relationship, the better that relationship, the better you will have an investment there. Value proposition. Who are you? What makes you memorable? I have trouble with names. My network is fairly big. People want access to my network, right? And I'm like, help me remember you. It's not just me, by the way. It's all of us, right? So why is it I'm going to remember you from anybody else? And why are you going to remember me from anybody else? What are you looking for? I'm looking for a marketer. I'm looking for a co-founder. I'm looking for understanding what technology stack I should put on. Great. I could be clear with what they asked you. Share your idea. But Dave, you don't understand my idea is special. Somebody will steal it. So Terry and I worked together for years. If we started 8 years ago, I think we worked together in 97. We started in 97 on the same idea, and we became anti-co-founders, right? With the same idea, our ideas would have gone this way. Because his life experience and my life experience is different. So even if somebody stole your idea, they would end up with a totally different product than you would end up with. Ideas die from a lack of exposure, not from overexposure. So every time I get a chance and I'm working on an idea, the difference between me at this point working on my idea and you working on your first idea is I'm looking for every reason this idea will fail, and I'm trying to kill it as fast as I can. Because I have other ideas I want to go pursue. For the person who has one idea, that one special idea, you don't want anybody to tell you their baby's ugly, because it's the only idea you have. And even if they tell you it's ugly, you're like, no, they're just idiots. They don't understand how good this idea is. And you may still work on that idea for 3 years. They'll show up at an event, they'll be 3 years from now, you're like, I'm still working on the same idea. I'm like, why? You can earn money back, but you can't get time back. Kill it. If it's going to die, find out how it's going to die as fast as you can. And then be clear with the message that can be repeated. So I'll give you an insight to venture capital. You're going to get to meet with somebody at Benchmark. They're an amazing venture capital firm. They're amazing. They're going to be a junior first-year associate. So I'm a junior first-year associate. Terry's my boss. Ed brings me his idea. I walk away going, Ed's really smart, but I can't repeat his idea. Be clear, that's what people can repeat. And I'm like, I met this guy. He had a really smart idea. I didn't really get what he got. And so now I have to tell Terry that I'm not smart enough to get Ed's idea because Ed didn't help me make it repeatable. So what will I tell my boss? I didn't see anything interesting. And you walk, and Ed walked out of me going, David and I connected. You totally got my idea. He's super excited because Benchmark's interested in investing in his company. And Terry says, hey. And I go, didn't see anything. Right? And that happens all the time because in your head, the idea is so amazing and it needs to pass the mom test. Like, can somebody repeat it easily or not? And if you go through that meeting and don't pass that test in advance, you lose. And that's the way every venture capital deal, and I've pitched over 100 VCs, every VC works the same way. All right, so this is a great example of what not to do. This came from LinkedIn. I realized I didn't get his name off his part. This came from a person who was a founder. Hey, Dave, quick question. We're working on a new product, and in the process of selecting people to interview, just answering several simple questions. Would you like to just say, name without? So my response, I'm not sure I'm going to be useful. Can you tell me what it is you're asking? But you've already asked me a question. Just give me the list of questions. We're building a blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. I mean, it's like, I still don't know. It's English. They are in sentence structures. I have no idea what the hell the person is asking. right? To which I have literally written, literally use text expander. So text expander is the thing I type in three characters, like semicolon and three letters, and it autofills something back. So I literally created an autofill for this type of reply. I basically said, okay, I know this is English, I know it's a sentence structure, I don't know what they're talking about. Because I get tired of typing that in over and over, so I just did it as a script, and it automatically filled it out. So don't be that person. You don't have to do that. You can actually make a good answer. So, ready. So, the mentors in this market really want to help. There's people who are chapter ahead of you. They want to help. You just need to make it easy for them to help. So my suggestion is what I call a two-paragraph LinkedIn message. Dear Dave, I am working this idea, not TLDR, by the way. Do you really know what TLDR is? Too long, don't read. Not that. Not a book. Two paragraphs. Dear Dave, I'm working on this idea, which we think is really helpful to this. Customer and benefit. Problem solution. I would like an introduction to so-and-so because I think it would be really helpful for the company. Right? Give me an actual reason. Then what I do is I get forward, type in that person's name, hit send, and they get to make the decision. But if I have to write a summary of your business case or try to summarize your book, the answer is no, I can't help you because I know there's stuff I'm working on. And I know your thing is the most important thing in the world to you, but to the rest of the world, it's just a request. So if you make it easy, it will work. Your ask ultimately has to be proportionate to your relationship. Again, don't ask me for introductions to Gary Rubens. Gary's is a great guy. Oh, how about Gary's an investor in previous companies, right? We'll introduce you to Gary. Go get traction. Go accomplish something. And then yes, but I'm going to ask you the preliminary questions before I actually send you to Gary, right? Or Rudy, or Amy, or Madrona. But you have to go accomplish those things first. So. The reason I mentioned Gary is this is Gary's auto signature. It says, time is our most valuable resource at home, and I won't waste yours. That's his auto signature on the bottom of this email. He's from the guy with money. So by the way, the investors have opinions on the checkbook, you have opinions. If you have opinions on data, like you talk about every potential customer, you win. If you have opinions on traction, you win. All right, embracing failure. This is my grandfather's garage, 1911. He opened the first Ford garage before the assembly line was actually started in 1914. So they sent pieces of the Ford Model T and assembled them in this garage. And there's this American Eagle motorcycle you can't see with enough detail. It's amazing. It's worth about $350,000 today. He sold that company too early. What? He started the first phone company in southwestern Washington. And then he sold that to her. Because there's no big garages in southwestern Washington with Parker's name on it that I know of, right? So embrace failure. 9 out of 10 startups fail. So what you should be working on is, how do I go prove that as fast as I can so I can go look on the next video? Everyone chooses a vocation. My wife could tell you maybe sick and twisted if you decide to choose that as a vocation, but after having done a bunch of them, the risk is high. The payoff is great. But you need to know what you're in for. So embrace that. Ultimately, I asked a bunch of times, why do you keep doing this? And the answer is, a lot of us have got together who are a group of founders who said, anytime they have an exit, we're going to take 10% of our proceeds of the exit and invest it back in the startups, Seattle startup. And we'll invest. So for those of you who are thinking about going to be a founder, I would encourage you to join me. It may take 7 or 8 years. That's okay. Give back, invest in the community. The one thing that makes San Francisco so uniquely different than Seattle and every other market is that you have a group like PayPal Mafia. Anybody ever heard that phrase? So there's a group of people who work together. They all exited PayPal, and then they all started investing in each other's deals. Companies like, I don't know, Tesla, and LinkedIn, and SpaceX. Right? All those folks were in the same market. So Peter Thiel, right, was one of them. Reid Hoffman was one of them. Elon Musk is one of them, but they all invested together. So as you get involved with your own entrepreneur journey, and as you make an exit in your company, I would encourage you, come invest 10% of that earnings back into the Seattle startup. Right? It'll pay off, come mentor. Right? The mentor hours will never pay off, other than knowing that you're passing it along. So again, back in 1988, I started my career, so I wouldn't have a lot of this around. So do great things, invest in your community. So my last one, always my favorite Yoda. Do or do not, there is no try. So you just have to decide. So with that, I'm going to open it up for questions. I know at the end of the time, immediately feel free. But if you have questions, feel free. And then my contact information is here. I do want sentence structures and I do want English. That's my only request. Yep. What can I answer for?
Yeah.
Quick question.
I don't
know if
you've heard it in here. What kind of startups like
you've
got
to
not
be in Malaysia
that we think are such
great
ideas?
So the first thing I would say is services companies. Quick rule of thumb: if you're going to build a services company, so where people are required to deliver all services for what I sell. So if I sell something, I need people to deliver a project, so IT services, etc. Those companies, when you grow them, they can be good and profitable companies. They're going to sell on average for 2 to 4x revenues. Product companies, where you build an app or an enterprise application or something like that, will sell on average between 4 and 8 and 15 times revenues. It takes just as many years to build either one of those. So there's no, this isn't a good or bad decision, this is just a no-how decision. Would I ever start a services company? Now, services companies, you can bootstrap, that rocks. But they're also hard to, they're impossible to raise funds for, and they're when you sell them, you're not going to get a great multiple. So, as an investor, I don't want services companies. As a, now, I lean towards the stuff I know. So, I know enterprise IT and software, right? So, there's things I know, and there's things I don't like, I don't really know much about that space. So, as an angel, I only do a couple deals a year. By the way, I don't consider myself an active angel. I know in Seattle, 2 deals a year, I'm an active angel. I'm an operator. Right, I'm an entrepreneur. There are more, way more active angels, but those are the type of things. The other things I don't like that are tough is that they're super risky and you have to be at scale. So think about everybody's familiar with that up into the right hockey stick. So you as a founder see the end of business is up into the right in this mature state. I look at it down here in this little intermediate state, and I'm concerned about the survival ability of it during the middle. So the more risk you take out of it, so from an enterprise IT perspective, I like that, as long as you have a wedge product that shows you when you go get traction. So just some general rules of thumb. Other questions? Really, I confused you all that, okay. All right, you're free to go. So you can all feel free if you want to reach out to me on LinkedIn, but all of the presentations up there as well as the blog. So.
Thank you, Dave.
Yeah.